Good afternoon, everybody. I know the first speech after lunch is always a tough one, but I'm looking out at this crowd and I'm wondering, there's got to be a hockey game somewhere here in Ottawa. My goodness, congratulations to Canada for the victory last night. As an American, I only have one thing to say. See you later this week, okay? Okay, enough of the hockey jokes. Gosh, you guys have a great team. I'm pretty worried about how we're gonna do, but we're just glad to be in the medal round, let me put it that way. Okay, I wanna speak to you about the climate change issue and what happened in Copenhagen. And I wanna actually build out of Jeff Rubin's remarks because I think he was largely spot on. Copenhagen was a pretty big disappointment. He used the word farce. I'm not sure if farce is true. Some of us have been in the trenches for multiple decades. I started working this issue in 1989. Thought I'd work on it a year or two, and I'm still plugging away. So, but indeed, a lot was at stake in Copenhagen. And my first graphic hopefully summarizes the story. If you remember nothing else about my speech, I hope you remember the expressions on the faces of these world leaders and ask yourself the question, why are the leaders of India and China smiling? Why is Barack Obama frowning? And why are the Europeans huddled in the corner worried about the future of the world? I think that pretty much summarizes what happened at Copenhagen, and I'll try to put some music to that theme in the next few minutes. I thought I should say a little bit about the science. The science has been in the news the last few months. The IPCC, which I have been a member for a long, long time, has been criticized, and please let me remind all of you, the IPCC is a pretty small, fragile organization. All of us are volunteers. We're not paid. We don't have any support from anybody. We don't have a publicity machine. It's just a group of scientists that work together that, in fact, try to do the best job we can at producing reports which can inform policymakers. We don't take policy positions. We just try to report the science the best we can. Do we make mistakes once in a while? Sure we do. We're human beings. But I just thought I'd speak to the IPCC because, in fact, we're working yet on another assessment. I'm sure we'll correct the mistakes that have been pointed out in the media the last few weeks, and we look forward to working together as a global community. For the students in the room, lots of opportunities in the science and engineering community for working on big global problems like climate change. And the IPCC has certainly been a group of people that have just tried to do the best they can, given the very, very limited resources that they have. I want to speak to this curve. This is the course data set started by Ralph David Keeling, who passed away a few years ago. But it's the CO2 curve that's quoted so commonly. And if remember one thing about the science, emissions continue to go up. We have, from the time I was born in the middle of 1950s to today, they've risen dramatically, about 390 parts per million, and we can measure it, and it's real, and there's no debate about the fact that we are dumping a lot of greenhouse gas emissions to the atmosphere. Secondly, I think it's fair to say that, indeed, some of the warmest years in recent history have occurred while we've all been alive, and this graphic depicts that. The red years, the hot years have been in the 80s, 90s, and the current decade. The very warm winter you're experiencing here in Canada, relatively warm, relatively low precipitation for some of the provinces. Certainly put a magnifying glass on that in Vancouver the last 10 days with the absence of snow in order to undertake a robust Olympics. It's related to the warming of the Pacific Ocean and the El Nino phenomenon. But I won't go into that today, but indeed, we are changing the chemistry and physics of the atmosphere, and it's something that the policymakers are considering as we move forward and think about shaping the globe's economy and its energy security. The top five greenhouse gas emitting countries. When I spoke here a few years ago, and I was one of the morning speakers here, I think in 2007 or 2006, the U.S. was still the top greenhouse gas producer at that time. That's no longer true. We're number two, and we're sliding down the list. I think China certainly is the largest greenhouse gas producer in the world. I think if Indonesia was honest about their greenhouse gas emission inventory, they too would be above the United States. They're probably underreporting the emissions from the burning of their forests and the large peatland deposits in Indonesia. So certainly the U.S. will drop below Indonesia in the next few years. Brazil moving towards the top of the list. and to India, of course, moving up very, very rapidly as they expand their economy at 8 to 10% a year. So the countries in the OECD, the wealthy nations of the world, at one time have a historic responsibility for their emissions, but they're beginning to slide down the list of greenhouse gas producers. Now, who are the top per capita emitters? Well, I'm glad to be here in Canada today. You're near the top of the list. With the United States and New Zealand and others, actually you're number 9, number 10 on the list. The U.S. is number 9. But these are the emissions that we produce on a per capita basis based on our population. And as you can see, indeed, as the previous speaker said, there is a lot of fossil energy consumption in the OPEC countries, and their emissions are correspondingly very high. Now, the road to Copenhagen, based upon all this science and the growing greenhouse gas emissions and the concerns about the impacts of the greenhouse gas emissions on the atmosphere's chemistry and physics, led world leaders to gather in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil in 1992, affectionately called the Earth Summit, great Canadian leadership for that meeting, and with something that we've all appreciated for a couple decades. The Earth Summit, of course, helped set the table for four major environmental treaties, the Climate Change Treaty just being one. There were also treaties that dealt with forests, desertification, and biological diversity. Out of the Earth Summit, of course, came the Framework Convention on Climate Change, which was developed relatively quickly, negotiated in 2 or 3 years, ratified very quickly, and now about 190 nations around the world have ratified, meaning formally adopted, the Climate Change Convention and the principles incumbent on that convention. Based on the success at the Earth Summit and negotiating the Framework Convention, of course, there was an aspiration to reach to a global treaty which would help us manage our emissions in the future. And that led us to, of course, Kyoto, Japan, just 3 years later. After the initial negotiations began, we had the convention established, and then we all began to gather in negotiating sessions. And from between 1995, 1996, 1997, we put together the Kyoto Protocol. I was in Kyoto. Very difficult negotiations, if some of you remember those heady days of 13 years ago. But in fact, we developed a treaty which just was not acceptable for many nations in the world, including my own nation. It also was a treaty that only dealt with less than half of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. So we needed to look to something different. And so we've been on this road to Copenhagen since we left Kyoto, trying to pull together an agreement which would begin to manage world greenhouse gas emissions. And of course, that helped set the table for over 120 world leaders gathering in Copenhagen to try to reach this goal of a global treaty. The Copenhagen Accord itself is a non-binding agreement. It was ground out after 10 days of negotiations. Basically, nothing was done on the accord until the 8th or 9th day of the negotiations. The world leaders convened, and I think you can tell from the output, the fact that this is a problem that's very big, very complex, very difficult, something that professional negotiators have been at for more than 2 decades. And to expect world leaders to parachute into the small city of Copenhagen and to agree on something as complex as a treaty to manage greenhouse gas emissions was just unrealistic. But nonetheless, Ban Ki-moon was there, the leader of the United Nations, or Prime Minister Rasmussen of Denmark said, "Y'all come, we'll figure this out in Copenhagen." And of course, expectations were much too high, the preparations were inadequate, and as a result, the Copenhagen Accord was put together rather hurriedly at the last minute. So indeed, it was not formally adopted by the Conference of the Parties or the UN body that actually convened in Copenhagen. It's non-binding. Currently, a fairly large number of countries have one way or the other stated their support for the Copenhagen Accord. There's various degrees of freedom in that support. China has issued a letter saying, well, they support parts of the Copenhagen Accord, and many other countries have done the same. So there's this process of cherry-picking the parts of the agreement that you think are best, and those are the ones that you're supporting. The countries, in principle, under the accord, are asked to implement economy-wide emission targets for 2020, only 10 years away. A pretty difficult thing to do for political leaders, understanding that by the time they complete their term in office, they won't have to live with the agreement, so some interesting dynamics there. The overall target is to stabilize greenhouse gas emissions that will result in about 2 degrees of warming, 2 degrees Celsius of warming. Right now we're about a degree of warming, so this is a pretty ambitious target considering the fact that they want to do this in the next few decades. But nonetheless, it was the target that was deemed reasonable by the large, by the majority of world leaders who convened there. The emission reduction pieces of the accord, of the non-binding accord, are interesting to say the least. The United States, the president, of course, committed to a 70% emission reduction. He went to the Copenhagen talks without any legislative validation of this target. And of course, he now finds himself in the predicament of having to fulfill his pledge in Copenhagen without the support of the House or the Senate to validate or ratify a piece of legislation. I don't think there's a very good chance of climate change legislation in the U.S. In this calendar year, 2010. I think it'll be somewhere pretty far down the road. If you're watching your Blackberries and watching the healthcare debate in the United States, you know that the U.S. president today is standing up arguing with the other party about healthcare. So I think climate change is a little bit farther down the list. China proposed a emission reductions of 40 to 45%. That sounds, whoa, that's a really big target. But then in fact, it's a business as usual scenario. It's no change from their traditional investments in emission reductions. India, of course, following China's lead, offered up 20 to 25% emission reductions. And the EU, of course, has been pretty steady with their 20 to 30% cuts. The one real deviation in Europe, of course, has been the pledge of Germany to cut emissions by 45%, which is far above what the other nations in Europe have pledged to do. There are very difficult verification provisions in the accord. I won't go into the detail here, but nonetheless, countries are actually expected to explain what their commitments are and how they be verified. And of course, this gets into very serious sovereignty issues, and the Chinese balked, the Indians balked, the Brazilians balked, the Americans balked at this one. Everybody choked hard on this particular part of the accord, and we'll see how that comes out in the future. The finance provisions splashed across the headlines of the world. My job at the World Bank is to actually help manage these funds. We are the trust fund for the climate change negotiations, and the wealthy nations committed the priestly sum of $100 billion per year by 2020 to help the poorer nations. I'm a little skeptical that this will actually be delivered. The treasuries are empty around the world, and these are public sector funds, but nonetheless, these were the commitments made at the time. I'm keen to see whether they'll be fulfilled in the next few weeks and months. There's also a pledge of short-term funding of $30 billion for the poor countries with the allocations for both adaptation and mitigation. So not only adapting to a changing climate, but also ways to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. I'm not holding my breath to see that these pledges are fulfilled. Why do the talks disappoint? Well, frankly, I thought expectations were way too high. Prime Minister Rasmussen, of course, flew around to virtually every capital of the world, begging and pleading for the leaders to attend the meeting. They did that, I'm sure, out of great sincerity, out of great hope that there would be a deal, a meeting of the minds in Copenhagen, but that in fact the foundations had not been laid by the Danes, by the United Nations process, or by other processes which supported the road to Copenhagen. The prior 2 years of negotiations just didn't get very much done. I know I was in the room for virtually all of those meetings, and they just didn't deal with the key issues of finance and verification and reducing greenhouse gas emissions. They often dealt with subsidiary issues. I think most importantly, the key parties didn't want a deal. Clearly, the Chinese didn't want a deal. The Indians didn't want a deal. Although the executive branch of the U.S. government went to Copenhagen hoping for a deal, they had no support from the House and the Senate, the federal Congress in the United States. So you'd have to say that although the big actors were in the room, it's not clear to me that any of them were committed to a deal. Why do I zero in on China, India, and the United States? Well, of course, they're responsible for about 55% of all the global emissions. So if you can't get the big three together, how could you possibly expect the rest of the world to come along? The issues are complex. I mean, if it were easy, we'd have done it already. This is one of my favorite cartoons on the climate change house that we've been building for two decades. And it's a mess. Nobody would want to live in this house. It's not sturdy, it's not durable, it's not sustainable. And indeed, we've got a very big challenge in front of us, trying to step aside and I guess forget or ignore our own sovereignty issues and try to work towards the goal of reducing the greenhouse gas emissions in the global commons. It's a very lofty goal. It's a goal that I've dedicated my career to, but that said, it's a very difficult one to achieve from a realistic perspective. Now, I just wanted to end on the thought of why is this thing so darn hard to achieve? And this is some of the numbers that Jeff Rubin talked about in the last speech. Here's the source data, some work that I did at the IEA a few years ago, where in fact we looked at the greenhouse gas emission patterns for the rich countries and the poor countries, the rich countries being the OECD countries. In the purple, the non-OECD are the rapidly developing countries, China, India, Brazil, Indonesia, and others. And you can quickly see that we've basically stabilized our emissions in the OECD world. We're not growing that rapidly in terms of emissions of greenhouse gases. That said, the rapidly industrializing economies of the world are dramatically increasing their greenhouse gas emissions. So even though perhaps Canada, the US, Europe, Japan, and other nations have historic responsibilities, most of the greenhouse gas emissions are going to go into the atmosphere and force additional climate change are going to come from developing countries. And that's a very difficult concept to negotiate and grasp. You've got historic responsibilities and you've got future emissions. Very difficult. The developing countries, of course, have asked that all of us become Luddites in the rich part of the world. That is, we should drive our emissions to cut them in half or go to zero. And this graphic describes why that's virtually impossible. Even if we all stopped driving our cars, changed homes, completely changed our lives, got out of the oil economy, greenhouse gas emissions in the developing countries would still continue to grow. So in fact, putting the burden on your back or my back as citizens of the OECD countries, just not reasonable. It's going to have to be a shared responsibility. That's a very difficult concept to negotiate. Also wanted to talk about the size of the problem. And you don't hear many people talk about the size of the problem because it's so immense, but try to break it down. We need to reduce emissions by about 55, 56 gigatons. It's based on our best models. Probably a pretty good number. It's not horrible. It's probably pretty close. And we need to do that in the next 3 or 4 decades. Well, that's a really big job. And I'm talking to the nuclear energy industry here. Zoom in on the yellow bar. The nuclear energy industry needs to build 136 new nuclear plants of 1 gigawatt apiece instead of the coal-fired power plants we're building today. And we need to do that on a regular basis the next 3 or 4 decades. Really big job. When's the last time on this planet that we built 136 new nuclear plants a year? Well, if we go back to the 60s and 70s, we marched towards that goal, but we never got there. Okay? So really big challenge. Now, it's not all going to be settled on the back of the nuclear industry or the renewables industry. It's obviously going to take a portfolio approach. And there's lots of roadmaps out there, the International Energy Agency, the United Nations, treaty after treaty, organization after organization. We probably know how to get this done. It all comes down to cutting a deal about for the parties that are involved and having the political will to make it happen and to incentivize it. So this is a roadmap from the International Energy Agency. It's widely published. I see it in Canadian newspapers all the time. And in fact, there's a big role for the nuclear energy industry, at least 6%, probably more than that in the future. And something to think about. Okay, I'm going to wrap this up by, what's the implications for this crowd and turn it to my other speakers. But I think there are some pretty serious ramifications coming out of Copenhagen. And I'm not going to give an alarmist perspective about the global climate. You can decide whether it's changing or not, whether you believe the science. But I do think that there are political ramifications for all of us to think about as we march forward in our day-to-day lives. First and foremost, we've already seen a lot of people distance themselves from the United Nations process. You saw last week Ivo de Boer, the executive secretary of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, resign. Anybody want that job? I got a job application in my back pocket for you. Not many people lining up for that one, let me tell you. And the UN process, I think, is in a pretty sad state of affairs. Now, I'm not here to criticize the UN. I've been a part of that negotiating process for a couple decades, but it's so much disappointment in and around the negotiations that we certainly have to take a second look at that UN negotiating forum. There'll be other negotiating fora that probably grow out of that process. One of them is the major economies process in which Canada participates, when in fact leaders or their deputies meet on a pretty regular basis to try to grapple with the climate change issue. So we'll see if these alternative negotiating venues lead to a faster track for negotiating a treaty. I think you're going to see the continuing rise of China, India, and Brazil in the negotiations. For two decades, China just wasn't very active in these negotiations. And I don't blame them. I mean, in fact, the negotiations were set up to fail in some ways, certainly with China being outside the box, not being responsible for any of the outcomes in the UN process. They could just kind of take it easy and watch things as they go along. Now I believe, due to the Copenhagen Accord and the commitments that their leaders have made on global stages, that they're going to become much more active in the negotiations. And I think that has big ramifications for those of us who borrow money from China or those of us who buy things from China and such. I think there's a changing world order here, and it's certainly going to be, I think, advanced in this post-Copenhagen environment. I put one in there just for the home crowd here, the U.S. nuclear energy legislation. I'm not so sure that we're going to see a climate change bill anytime soon. I've said that a number of times during this speech. But I do think we're going to see more energy legislation in the U.S. that's going to do what they can to continue to push this mini renaissance forward. I think it's going to deal with natural gas and other fuel sources. It won't be nuclear wins all, but I think there will be continuing push towards zero emissions. Innovators will continue to lead. Last week, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission in the U.S. granted Google a license to become a wholesale and energy retail body in the United States. Now, scratch your heads, Google, why Google? Well, of course, Google's wired into just about every home in the United States and in many homes and businesses around the world. And of course, they're very well positioned to help you think about how you use your energy and how you manage your greenhouse gas emissions. So in fact, there are the creative souls around the world that are stepping up in the detritus of the disappointments in Copenhagen to do something different. And then finally, I think provincial governments, state governments, local governments are going to play a bigger role. And certainly without any leadership in Washington, that will be true south of the border here. Finally, I just thought I'd say something about carbon markets. Denise asked me to say something about carbon markets, and golly jeepers, Copenhagen didn't do much to help the carbon markets. They're on their way south until we fix a price for carbon or, in fact, develop the institutions to deal with carbon issues. I think you're going to see a continued kind of floating along of the carbon market. There's a lot of banks and energy firms and others that are in the carbon trading business, an uncertain time for them. And we'll see how that unfolds, but certainly the uncertainty with regard to climate change legislation, not only in the U.S., but in Australia and other parts of the OECD, has created an era of uncertainty. I've covered a lot of information in the last few minutes, and a lot of it's kind of complex, touched on a lot of topics, but please feel free to write to me or call me. I'll be glad to chat with you about these issues, and thanks for your kind and wonderful Canadian hospitality. I always enjoy this meeting, and again, we'll see you later this week on the ice, okay? Bye-bye.